Welcome to my classroom. I do hope you will find the attached video on quantitative descriptions of failure both useful and enjoyable. Enjoy.
Failure takes place when a unit, which can be a machine or a subpart of a machine or a component, stop fulfilling its purpose. There are typically a few ways in which failure can occur for the same unit. Such different mechanisms of failure are called failure modes. So, for example, a gearbox might fail because of bearing failure, or lubrication failure, or shaft failure, or even quite a number of other ways in which failure occurs. In each such case, the specific failure will be called one of the modes of failure of the unit. An important condition for identifying such failure modes in practice is that such failure modes are actual ways in which failure has occurred in the specific business and plant unit. Even when you have, say, the same gearbox installed in more than one production unit, it is not to say that in both cases, the same failure modes will be discerned. We mostly make use of failure statistics from the past to understand exactly what the failure entails. This then enables us to take the appropriate decision regarding the strategy for managing a specific failure mode. And depending on the type of unit, the statistics that we utilize also differ. Components typically only experience a limited number of failure modes, and the component is mostly either replaced at failure or might in some cases be repaired such that it can fulfill its function again. In both cases, that is in replacement and repair, the component is normally deemed to be fully functional. We say the component has been renewed. From this follows the term renewal. We also say that the component is as good as new to describe the effect of renewal. In the case of machines, the situation is more complex. Typically, such unit can suffer many failure modes occurring when one or more components of the unit fails. In this case, when the specific component is renewed, that is replaced or repaired, the total machine is not repaired to the as good as new condition. That is because only this one component of the unit has been renewed. All the other components are just as old as they were before the unit failed. In such instance, we talk of a repairable system. We have repaired the system by renewing the one component which failed so that it can further function, but we have not renewed the system. In such a case, we also talk of the system being as bad as old after the repair, signifying that the repair enabled it to once more fulfill its function, just like it did before the failure, but the unit has not been fully restored. When we investigate the failure of components, we find that they tend to fail at a constant rate. Not all components of a certain type will fail at exactly the same age. Their failures can normally be pictured by a statistical distribution that shows that failures occur over a spectrum of ages. However, when you calculate the average life of a specific component, it tends to stabilize at a certain value for a specific component used in a specific set of circumstances. An example which most of us know well is that of your car's tires. You have a certain expectation of the life that you will get from a set of tires. Such expectation is based on your historic experience of the lives that your tires achieved in the past. Necessarily, this average may differ from one make of tire to another, and also if your driving habits or the type of roads that you frequent changes. But for one specific make of tire in a specific set of running circumstances, you will find that the lives are very much the same over the life of the car. The same goes for other components of the car or other types of equipment. So the rate at which failure occurs is fairly constant for components. However, in the case of machines, we find that the rate at which failure occurs tend to increase as the unit ages. The unit is made up of many components that each fail at its own specific constant rate, as we discussed just now. Nevertheless, when the unit is new, no failures will occur for a considerable period. If we remain with the example of a car, we can maybe say that the first failure is when the first set of tires need to be replaced, say at 50,000 kilometers. Now we expect to have another failure for tire replacement after another 50,000 kilometers. But that is not all. At say 70,000 kilometers, we need to replace the battery, which will then on average need the replacement every 70,000 kilometers into the future. And then you say at say 80,000 kilometers, something else fails, and so on. As more and more components fail for the first time, the load of repeat occurrences increase, causing the rate of failure to increase. This increasing trend will only be changed into a constant rate when all the components of the unit have failed at least once. And normally such unit will by then have been replaced. Now, this rate at which failure occurs will logically be called by the name failure rate. But we tend to shy away from that term because it has been used wrongly in the history of failure analysis. We will later in this session encounter the instantaneous failure rate of components. That is the failure rate at the specific point in the component's life. It depends on the past history of the component. But it is not the simple failure rate of the component, which just depends on the number of failures over time. And this is exactly the problem. Statisticians have in the past begun to call the instantaneous failure rate of a component the failure rate, which it is not. And now if we talk of the failure rate of a machine, which is just the number of failures over time, and someone else talks of the failure rate of a component, meaning the instantaneous failure rate, it is not only causes confusion of terms, but also confusion of as good as new situations of components with as bad as old situations of repairable systems. So responsible practitioners have banned the term failure rate totally. So we rather talk of the rate of occurrence of failures, which tends to be a constant in the case of components and tends to increase over time in the case of systems, that is repairable systems. This rate of occurrence of failures is abbreviated by the acronym ROCOF. In the case of components, we call the instantaneous rate of failure by one of two names, that is hazard rate or force of mortality. The term hazard rate is maybe the best in industrial situations, while the term force of mortality, abbreviated FOM, is used more for the purposes of actuarial analyses. The term hazard rate is also an accurate characterization of the instantaneous nature of this calculated property, which is a measure of the risk of failure as it progresses throughout the component's life. This is then a fundamental rule. Never use the term failure rate. In the case of components, use hazard rate. And in the case of systems, use ROCOF, that is the rate of occurrence of failures. Just before we end this discussion, the question, what is the relationship between the hazard rate and the ROCOF? There is no relationship, but in both cases, the term failure rate tended to be used, and that is exactly why that term has been banned. Before progressing deeper into this subject area, let us quickly list the descriptions of failure, which we are going to cover in the remainder of the session. We will also give a short definition of each. Number one, the ROCOF, that is the rate of occurrence of failures. This is the rate at which failures occur and which we have discussed fairly well up to here. The ROCOF tends to be constant for components and increasing for systems. We call this increasing rate by the name reliability degradation. We normally do not use this for components, simply because it does not tell us much, since it is constant. Two, MTTF, that's the mean time to failure. This is the average life and is calculated as 1/ROCOF. The MTTF, like the ROCOF, tends to be constant for components and decreasing for systems. Again, we call this decreasing life by the name reliability degradation. And as in the case of the ROCOF, we normally do not use this for components simply because it does not tell us much, since it is constant. Number three, failure density. This is the statistical probabilities of the occurrence of various lives described by a statistical distribution. It is applicable to components. Because systems tend to have an increasing Rokoff, its individual lives are decreasing and thus no repeating lives are encountered, making any distribution absurd. Number four, the cumulative failure distribution. Exactly what it says. It is the accumulation of failure probabilities as life increases. Again, only applicable to components. Number five, survival function. The probability that a unit will survive up to a certain age without any failure. Only applicable to components. Number six, hazard function. The instantaneous probability of failure, also called the conditional probability of failure, as discussed before, only applicable to components. The first two of the six commonly used quantitative failure statistics typically describe the failure behavior of systems. Number one, the Rokoff. The Rokoff is an indication of how fast failures are following one another. It is calculated by dividing the number of failures by some quantitative measure of the cumulative use of the system or the component. The divisor often consists of the cumulative number of operating hours, but could just as well be the number of shifts, or days, or weeks, or months, or years, or some measure of production delivered, such as tons, or cubic meters, or units produced. The Rokoff is a very useful measure in determining whether the reliability of a system or a subsystem is busy improving, that is the Rokoff decreasing, constant, or decreasing, that is the Rokoff increasing over time. See the figure. The Rokoff can also be used to determine the economic life of a system. The graph also introduces another concept. An increasing Rokoff is called a sad system. The increasing Rokoff represents reliability degradation and is thus sad. A constant Rokoff is called non-committal, indicating no change in reliability. This is the situation encountered for components. Lastly, a decreasing Rokoff is called a happy system. This is a system where reliability growth is experienced and is typical of improvement drives. That is, when projects are introduced to achieve business improvement. This can be technical improvement or organizational improvement. Number two, mean time to failure, that is MTTF. The mean time to failure, or the MTTF, is the inverse of the Rokoff. Thus, where the Rokoff represents the number of failures per time or other measuring unit, the MTTF is the average life between successive failures in operating hours or other measuring unit. It thus serves the same purpose as the Rokoff and is sometimes preferred by maintenance people because of its ease of interpretation. As is the case with a decreasing Rokoff, an increasing MTTF will be an indication that the system's reliability is improving, while a decreasing MTTF, like an increasing Rokoff, will indicate reliability degradation. See the figure. The last four of the six commonly used quantitative failure statistics typically describe the failure behavior of components. Number three, the failure density. That's the first of the four functions for components. The failure density gives a picture of the probability of failure of a component over its own life. It thus gives at any particular point in the life of the component the probability of failure at exactly that point. A typical failure density function is shown in the figure. For this component, the probability that it will fail at a life of exactly 2000 hours is 0.03%. Number four, cumulative distribution function. By cumulative summation of the probabilities of failure as shown in the figure, the cumulative failure distribution results. It gives the probability that a component will have failed before or at any point in time or other measuring unit of its life. The cumulative failure distribution always starts at the probability of zero, declaring that a new component will not be in the first state. It will always eventually accumulate to a value of 1 or 100%, indicating that the component will eventually fail with 100% certainty. The cumulative failure distribution is derived from the failure density as follows. This is not for our density function, but illustrates the concept. The resultant cumulative failure distribution for our failure density is shown in the figure. For this component, the cumulative probability that it will fail before or at a life of 2,000 hours is 30%. Number 5, the survival function. The cumulative failure distribution gives the probability of failure before or at a certain age. By subtracting the cumulative failure distribution from 1 or 100%, in other words, the space above the curve of the cumulative failure distribution, the probability that the component will survive up to that age results. This is a very useful measure, as it gives the percentage of units that will survive up to a specific age. The survival function is derived from the cumulative failure distribution as follows. This is again not for our functions, but illustrates the concept. The survival function always starts at a probability of 1 or 100%, declaring that a new component will not be in the failed state. It will always eventually decrease to a value of 0, indicating that the component will eventually fail with 100% certainty. The resultant survival function for our data set is shown in the figure. For this component, the probability of it surviving to an age of 2,000 hours is 70%. Number 6, the hazard function. The most useful of the last four quantitative measures is the hazard function. It is also called the conditional probability of failure or the momentary probability of failure or the force of mortality function. It gives the probability that the component will fail at a certain life, given that it has survived up to that age. It is calculated at a specific age by dividing the value of the failure density at that age by the value of the survival function at the same age. It is a measure of the risk of failure of the component at that specific age. The hazard function for the failure situation in our previous figures is shown in the figure. For this component, the risk of it failing at an age of 2,000 hours, given that it has already survived up to that age, is 0.045% per hour. The force of mortality can have three basic shapes: increasing, constant, or decreasing. This is shown in the figure. These three shapes and their significance are described in the table. The principle of lowering the risk of failure through use-based replacement is illustrated in the figure for the case of an increasing force of mortality. If the force of mortality or the hazard is decreasing with age or constant, there will be no incentive towards use-based preventive maintenance, as the risk after such maintenance action will not be lower than before it. In such a case, the only preventive strategy available will be that of condition-based preventive maintenance. But in case of an increasing hazard, that is a situation often encountered in components, use-based preventive maintenance will certainly be an option, as that will lower the risk of failure. Whether or not one uses use-based preventive maintenance in such circumstances will depend on the economics of such action and whether condition-based preventive maintenance does not afford a better option.
Thank you for viewing this video with me. Goodbye.